Good morning. I'm Jamila Moore, president of Kenyatta College. Welcome to our campus. We are delighted to host this town hall meeting with one of Kenyatta College's and the San Mateo County Community College District's biggest champions, supporters and friends, and a tireless advocate for our students and our region, Congresswoman Jackie Speier. Congresswoman Speier, I just have a little more verbiage here, just a little. Congresswoman Speier is serving her sixth term in the U.S. House of Representatives, where she serves on the House Select Committee on Intelligence and the Armed Services Committee, where she serves as chair of the Subcommittee on Military Personnel. Prior to her election to the U.S. House, Congresswoman Speier served on the San Mateo County Board of Supervisors and as a member of the California Assembly and the California State Senate. Among her numerous awards and honors, Congresswoman Speier was named to Newsweek's list of 150 most fearless women in the world. And for those of you who know the Congresswoman, that is no surprise. A fearless fighter for women's rights, a strong national defense and safety, health and rights of ordinary Americans, Congresswoman Speier continues to work to keep housing and student loans affordable to protect private information from cyber attacks, cyber espionage, to end discrimination against transgender soldiers, to promote research of Alzheimer's and breast cancer. Top among her concerns for us, her constituents, is making sure there are good jobs with good wages along with affordable housing for the workers of the Bay Area. Please join me in welcoming our great friend, supporter, and a talented and dedicated public servant, Congresswoman Speier. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Moore. Thank you all for being here. For those of you who are standing in the back, there are lots of seats over here. I shouldn't say lots, but there is enough. So I want to thank you all for coming here for the 18th conversation about America that we have held since President Trump became the President of the United States. I want to thank Mitchell Bailey, the Vice Chancellor and Chief of Staff of the San Mateo County Community College District. Mitchell. There he is. John Kenny, who's the theater manager here at Kenyatta College, for all his assistance. John, I don't know exactly where you are, but thank you. To Tammy Robinson, who is the Vice President of Instruction here at the college. Tammy. And the beloved Tom Moore, former member of the Community College District trustee and also the superintendent of schools for the San Mateo Union High School District for many years. Tom, wherever you are, thank you so much for being here. And then from the San Mateo Community College District Board of Trustees, our Vice President, Karen Schwartz. We have a number of elected officials here. I'm delighted that you're here. Donna Colson, the mayor of Burlingame. Donna. Michael Brownrigg, who is also a member of the Burlingame City Council and candidate for the State Senate. Sally Lieber, former State Assembly member and Mountain View Council member and also a candidate for the State Senate. Marie Schwang on the Hillsborough Town Council. Then if I have forgotten any electeds, please let... Rick Bonilla from the city of San Mateo. So if I've forgotten anyone else, please let Ryan or Katrina know, and we'll make sure you're announced. Okay, so we're doing this slightly differently because so much has happened in the last 2 weeks. We're going to start off with a conversation about the migrant tragedy that is occurring on our border. I'm going to show you some slides that I took as part of my second visit to McAllen, Texas, in about a year. And then we're going to hear from a recent asylum seeker who is now living in Half Moon Bay. Then we're going to shift gears, and I'm going to show you some slides about gun violence prevention. And then we're going to hear from a representative of the Brady campaign in the Oakland chapter. And then we're going to open it up to questions you have on any issue. But because these issues are so current, and I am so troubled by what is going on, I wanted to at least alert you to what has been happening. So if someone can give me the clicker, is the clicker here? This is the trip I made to the border. Now, this is the first time we've ever been able to take pictures inside the Border Patrol Station and the processing center. And the only reason why that happened was because I, less than 24 hours before we left, and I led a group of about 20 members of the House of Representatives on this trip, I called the House Counsel and asked them whether or not the Border Patrol could prevent us from taking pictures. And I got an opinion that said, no, they can't. So when they asked us to leave our phones, when they asked us to leave our phones in the room, I says, no, we're taking our phones in. We have a House Counsel opinion. And they shut right up. All right. This is what is called the McAllen Border Patrol Station. It looks like a small county jail. What you're seeing here are young men who were picked up, some 2,000 of them were picked up over a two-day period. And they're waiting there about to be put into a cell. I don't know why this picture is here. Except you see me looking pained and talking to someone, and you can see some of the Border Patrol officers in the background. Joining me here is Anna Custer from the state of New Hampshire. These two pictures are so painful to me. On your left is a picture of a cell with a young man who is showing me that he has been in that cell for 40 days without a shower and without being able to brush his teeth. And you see the photo next to him, and those are just young men praying, asking for help. Now, this is at the processing center. This is all the caged areas that you've been hearing about. And I am there. You see a small child. His mother is with him, and the Mylar blankets are there. Last year when I went, children were being separated from their parents in that county jail-like facility, and kids were frightened and crying. The only thing that has changed in this horrific set of circumstances is that they're not separating as many parents and children. There are still some that are being separated. Here you can see these are caged areas, and you can see that there are numbers of families. There's been a 269% increase in the number of families attempting to come to the United States seeking asylum. In this left photo is a father with his small child who is very sick, and he is awaiting being able to go to the hospital. This, as you can see, is a small infant with his mother. This is the Catholic Charities Humanitarian Respite Center, and these are some of my colleagues. And we are conducting a press conference here. We had just met with probably, I'd say, 75 to 100 detainees that have been released from the processing center and are now going to their sponsors, typically by bus. Now, sponsors are persons who are willing to have them come live with them, their family members or relatives of some sort, and they pay either for the bus ticket or the airline ticket. So it makes much more sense to have these people process quickly, get to their family members, than spending taxpayer dollars of anywhere between $300 and $700 a day going to private prison operations. And here we are talking to one of the recently released asylum seekers. And this last photo is heartbreaking. He has been released and is at one of these respite centers. If you look at his feet, he's got tinfoil on his feet. I think what they've done here is taken a Mylar blanket and turned it into shoes for him. And this is not America. This is not my America. I don't think it's your America. This is another respite center called the Good Neighbor Settlement House. I'm here with Andy Levin, who's a congressman from Michigan, and one of my staff members who's fluent in Spanish, Alexandra. And we are talking to some of those who've been recently released and are going to family members. We then went to Brownsville and crossed the Rio Grande, across the border going into Mexico. And I'm standing about the same place where the father and his young daughter were found drowned. This is called the La Lista. This is the list of over 2,000 names of people that are on the Mexico side of the border waiting to, at some point, be given the opportunity to seek asylum. And this is what makes America so great. Twice a day, at 6 a.m. in the morning and 6 p.m. in the evening, Brownsville neighbors, U.S. citizens, take wagons full of food, cross the border, and go to this location and feed the migrants waiting on that side. And this particular evening, we fed them dinner. And that's Congressman Susie from the state of New York. He was doing a better job dishing food out than I was. And here is how they say some of these people have been waiting months, and the Brownsville port of entry is only taking 20 people a day. Now I want to introduce you to Doreen Matute Mateo and Sweet Natalie, who's 4 years old. They are now residents of Half Moon Bay and are in the process of seeking asylum. And Belinda Hernandez-Sariaga, who is the assistant professor at the University of San Francisco and a licensed clinical social worker, who is going to join us to translate. She's also a member of the Bay Area Border Relief Group that has made, I think, 4 or 5 trips now to the border to provide assistance to those in need. So please welcome Dorian, Belinda, and Natalie. Natalie is famous, isn't she, all of a sudden? So, Dorian, tell us why you left Honduras.
Dorian, ¿puedes explicar por qué te viniste de Honduras?
Hola a todos. Mi nombre es Dorian y estoy con mi hija Natalie. y somos de Honduras. Tenemos un par de meses de estar aquí en California y pues uno de los motivos por el cual decidimos dejar nuestro país es por amenazas a muerte, amenazas por mi hija y por mi persona. Y fue uno de los motivos por los cuales decidí dejar mi país y venir a buscar un sueño diferente aquí a América.
Hello, my name is Dorian. Thank you so much for having us here. And this is my daughter, Natalie. And we're from Honduras. And the reason why we came is because of threats of death against myself and also my daughter. And we came to the United States in hope of a future free from fear.
Why were they threatening your death?
¿Por qué estaban amenazando muerte contra usted, Dorian?
De un principio, cuando tenía a mi padre vivo y mi hermano, mi familia trabajaba en un negocio propio y pues lamentablemente en mi país, cuando empiezas a crecer con tu negocio, están las pandillas en mi país que si no pagas extorsión o renta, como le decimos en mi país, te dan término de un mes, dos meses, y si no logras pagar ese dinero, pues te matan. Y vemos que eso lo... ellos no tienen mucho tiempo para esperar, y si te cobran 5,000 lempiras por cada mes, eso tiene que estar puntual de tu trabajo. Y pues ellos, al ver que tú no quieres colaborar con las pandillas, pues empiezan a matar tu familia. Al principio, desde un principio todo ha sido muy duro con parte de la familia de mi padre, porque de lo que ha sido mi padre, mi mamá y mi hermano, pues ya de nosotros cuatro solo estoy yo y mi mamá por aparte, y, pero ya con mi hermano y mi padre ya pues ya en la otra vida.
So from the beginning, my dad and brother had a business, and what happens in Honduras is when you have a business and you start to make money. ¿Qué era el negocio, Dorian? ¿Estaban sembrando?
El negocio de nosotros era la agricultura, la tierra.
An agricultural business is what they were developing. And in Honduras, when you are starting a business or have a business, the gang members there try to extort the money from the folks that are making, you know, doing the work. So they'll ask you to come and pay, or they'll demand payment of what you're making in the field or in your job. And so they were demanding the money of his brother and his dad. Ultimately, they were killed, both of his brother and his father. And Dorian is left behind as the oldest to kind of care for his family, but also he lives in this fear of what happened to his family.
So is his mother and wife still there?
So su mamá está allí y su esposa, la mamá de Natalie, ¿verdad? Sí. Yes, yes.
Can he tell us about how long it took him to come here and then what it was like in the detention facility?
Dorian, ¿puedes decir cuánto tiempo te tomó de venir aquí a Estados Unidos de Honduras y también un poquito cómo le fue en el centro de detención? Pero me das un momento de traducir.
Sí, cuando tomé mi viaje de Honduras acá a América, nos tomó casi aproximadamente como un mes y medio para venir a hasta la frontera.
Leaving Honduras to the U.S., it took us about a month and a half to get to the border, to make it to the border of the U.S. from Honduras.
Did he have to pay a coyote?
¿Tuviste que pagar coyote?
No, eso solamente cuando estaba en la frontera, pagué por que me cruzara el río, nada más.
He made it all the way here on his own, but then when he got to the border, had to pay someone, a coyote, to cross him over the river.
And how much was that?
¿Y cuánto pagaste, Dorian?
Pagué $5,500.
$5,500.
And how, what was it like, and how long was he in the detention facility, and was he ever separated from Natalie?
¿Y cómo fue en el centro de detención, y si alguna vez estaba separado de Natalie, o cómo era para ella también?
Cuando cruzamos el río, pues venían 47 personas más atrás de mí.
When we crossed the river, there was 47 people behind me.
Veníamos todos en camino y todos los que venían atrás de mí, las demás personas que venían con niños menores de edad, todos ellos estaban cruzando por primera vez. Y cuando nos cruzaron, preguntaron si alguien había cruzado alguna vez el río y pues les dije que yo ya lo había intentado varias veces. Y entonces me dijeron que los encaminara hacia el otro lado del río. Nos cruzaron a la mitad del río, y del río para allá, de la mitad del río, pues ya lo tuvimos que cruzar caminando con el agua a la cintura.
And the others that were coming behind them were all families with little ones, and they were coming to the United States for the first time. And so Dorian, they asked, you know, if it was her first time that they were coming. Dorian had tried before, but he said that then they crossed them through the river, and it was, era peligroso. Sí. And it was dangerous for the crossing for the children as well. Y en el centro.
Luego, pues, caminamos como dos horas y media hasta que llegó migración.
They walked for 2.5 hours until immigration found them.
Y, pues, empezaron a tomar datos y a repartir las personas en carros diferentes, menores de edad a un lado y los que veníamos con niños aparte.
Then they started separating families with little ones, and older children were separated in other vehicles.
Luego nos llevaron a un lugar que comúnmente nosotros los centroamericanos le llamamos la hielera.
Then they took us to a place where Central Americans call la hielera, which is, stands for ice box.
It's Ursula, I think.
Estuve en la hielera cuando migración nos agarró. Entré como a las 5 de la tarde y salí a las 9 de la mañana del día siguiente.
He was in there from 5 in the la hielera in the day until the next day at 9 in the morning.
Nunca separaron a la niña de mí. Y donde estaba yo, pues habían otros hondureños más con sus niños también. Y es un lugar muy frío, como cuando te meten a un refrigerador, muy helado, no hay nada con que abrigarse, no hay comida, no hay nada hasta cuando sales de ahí.
So he said that they were put into a place where they weren't given food, no estaban comiendo, ¿verdad? And that there were other children that were apart from their families. He never was separated with Natalie. But it was cold and they didn't eat.
Después que llegó el día siguiente,
the next day,
salimos del lugar la hielera y ya me llevaron a la detención donde llevan a las demás personas.
Then they were taken to detention where the other folks were placed.
Luego de ahí estuvimos, tuvimos 5 días con mi nena. Tampoco nos separaron, siempre estuvimos juntos. 5 días hasta esperar a que, pues, migración me diera la oportunidad de dejarme libre. Y gracias a Dios, pues, así fue. Fue un poco duro todo porque, pues, la diferencia entre la hielera y lo que comúnmente nosotros los hondureños llamamos detención es algo similar, es igual, siempre muy frío.
So, we were never separated, me and Natalie, but it was very hard time. And the difference between La Hielera and detention center is not very different. It's still both equally really cold and really hard place to be.
And he was there how long?
¿Cuántos días estuvieron en total?
Prácticamente como 6 días detenido.
6 days that they were detained.
And now you're living in Half Moon Bay. And what are you doing?
Y ahora vives en Half Moon Bay. ¿Y cómo, qué estás haciendo y cómo es tu vida ahí?
En un principio, cuando salí de la detención, conocí a mi amiga Belinda.
When I came out of detention, he met me in the Bay Area Border Relief Team.
Y me hablaba mucho sobre lo que es el estado de California.
In McAllen, right?
In McAllen. Mm-hmm.
Me hablaba mucho sobre el estado de California.
Oh, we talked to him a lot about California. We did.
En un principio no tenía, cuando salí de migración no tenía dónde ir. Estuve albergado en una iglesia en McAllen.
When I was released from detention, I really didn't have a place to go. I was at the respite center at Catholic Charities Respite Center in McAllen, Texas.
Estuve ahí como una semana, más de una semana creo.
And he was there almost a week.
Cuando llegué, salimos 300 personas y empecé como a adaptarme a lo que pues la vida me estaba dando nuevamente. Y me recuerdo que cocinaba comida ahí en la detención con otros amigos, prácticamente comida casi para 700, 800 personas que llegaban diario.
So 300 other people were there with him, and he started to volunteer to cook for the other people that were coming in during the time that he was there.
Y luego pues logré como viajar para la Florida, y pues también allá es muy duro en la Florida, y luego decidí hablar con Belinda, y pues gracias a Dios me mudé para acá, California, y hoy estoy en Halmon Bay.
So he was able to go finally to Florida, but it was really hard life there. Things were not going well at all for job, for employment, and being able to have, you know, support. So he contacted us, and we were able to get him a place in Halmon Bay. And
aparte de todo, pues desde mi viaje de Honduras acá a América, como ha sido un viaje de muy largo, de un lugar a otro, de luego para acá, adaptarse, tanto sufrimiento, tantas cosas que viví en el camino. Pues yo siempre le doy gracias a Dios porque lo que es California, veo muchas personas que son de buen corazón, no hay discriminación a nosotros los hondureños, nosotros los centroamericanos. Y en esa parte, pues con orgullo lo digo que nos sentimos bien, porque siempre encuentras personas que te brindan apoyo.
Apart from all the suffering on the road, the journey, they went through so much, being in detention and this whole process, he has to say that being in California has been special because people have had opened their hearts to them, and he sees that there's not the discrimination against the Central Americans here in this area. And he feels very proud that he's in California to be able to be with this community.
And when is his asylum date? When is his asylum hearing?
Dorian, ¿cuándo es su cita de asilo, su corte?
Desde un principio, cuando llegué, cuando salí de la detención, como estuve en migración, todos mis días que estuve detenido, siempre le oraba a Dios que me diera la oportunidad de poder estar legal o con un permiso aquí en América.
When he was in detention, he would pray every day that God would grant him the opportunity to be in this country, to be able to have asylum, to be safe.
Y pues no tenía una persona que me recibiera, no tenía ni un número de teléfono a quien llamar.
He didn't have any sponsor, he didn't have anyone to receive him.
O una persona que respondiera por mí.
Or someone that would respond for him.
Y pues tanta súplica y pedirle a Dios, ya casi digamos que a los 6 días salí de migración.
And after so much prayer and after 6 days of being able to get out of immigration,
me dejaron cita para lo que era ahí en Texas.
They gave him a court date in Texas.
Y luego que llegué a Florida, me presenté a migración.
And then when he went to Florida, he also presented himself to immigration there.
Estuve intentando firmar mis papeles en Miami durante 4 días.
He was trying to process all his paperwork in Miami during the time there.
Y no había forma de cómo me lo firmaran porque era demasiadas personas que se presentaban.
But they were having a hard time getting through the immigration because there were so many people that they were trying to process.
Todos los días viajaba con mi nena, pagaba siempre un Uber a las 3 de la mañana para que me fuera a dejar a migración, y hasta que logré entrar.
Every day he would go in an Uber in Miami, wake up at 3 a.m. with Natalie to wait in line in immigration to try to present himself. ¿Y después de cuántos días, Orián?
De 4 días.
4 days that he tried every day, and he was finally able to present himself after those 4 days.
Después de los 4 días, las personas me decían que no me presentara porque ya había pasado el tiempo en el que tenía que yo presentarme a migración.
That people were telling him that the days had already passed that he was supposed to present himself into immigration.
Y siempre he sido una persona que ha tenido fe y me ha gustado ser muy positivo y pues le dije a Dios, si en verdad tengo que estar en América, así va a ser, y si no, pues con dolor en el alma, pues regresar a Honduras.
But he's always had faith and he's always tried to do the right thing, and with trust, you know, he knew that he would be able to present himself. Y para terminar, Dorian, dice ya.
Ahora estoy aquí en California.
And now tengo, here in California.
Tengo mi cita para en septiembre.
He has a date in September.
Y solamente pedirle a Dios que todo salga bien y
and he's praying everything will
tener
turn
siempre esa
okay.
oportunidad y de demostrarle a los americanos que nosotros centroamericanos somos buenas personas.
And to demonstrate to Americans, to the United States, that Central Americans are good people.
Y le digo a esas personas que a veces piensan mal de nosotros.
We know sometimes they think bad about us.
Creo que todos en la vida merecemos una oportunidad para demostrar quiénes somos.
But I feel that in life we all deserve an opportunity to show who we are and what we can do.
Thank you, Darian. Thank you very much. Natalie, thank you. Thank you, Belinda. What did you say, Natalie?
Gracias.
Gracias.